First of all, I would like to thanks to the General Chair, Professor Abdul Aziz, to invite me to join to this very prestigious conference, the 7th International Conference on Multimedia Computing and System, yeah, ICM CS 2020. So I'm very glad also today I can meet my old friend at the time, Professor Muhammad Ezaidi. I saw also Professor Zaz is there, so really nice to meet you again here. Number one is the overview data visualization based on the computational intelligence, AI, and data mining. So I'm going to share with you what kind of data gathering that we do, how we doing the visualization. I will give you like two examples today. One is related with to the COVID-19, yeah? And I will give a brief introduction for those who are still new. If, for example, you have the question, for example, what is the difference between CI and AI? What is the difference between computational intelligence and artificial intelligence? Okay, and we're going to implement it in the data mining area, and after that, we do the visualization. And the second agenda, I'm going to talk about the how we monitoring the COVID-19 in Indonesia. All right, just for your information, we are in Indonesia. We have like 17,504 islands, basically. So very huge island, very big number of the island. We have five big island, and the COVID-19 come to every single island, basically. And we try to concentrate to the epicentrum for every single island, the big one. So you're going to see a couple of the visualization based on the map, basically, how the virus spread it out. And then the third agenda here, I'm going to talk about the how we do the prediction, which is very hard to predict the COVID-19 because of the environment. It's not, sometimes it's not matching with the model that we develop, yeah? And we want to learn about can we predict when the number of the COVID-19, people who are infected with COVID-19 can turn down. When, for example, we ask, what is the data visualization? So basically, data visualization is the graphical representative of the information and the data. Yeah. So we using the visual element, like for example, like chart, graph, math, maps, yeah, and so on. And sometimes we use also the data visualization tools to see the trend, for example, or the outlier or the pattern of the data. So that basically the basic idea what data visualization is. If you see from my slide here, so you can, just a moment, I lost my slide at the moment. So usually I ask to the audience if we have like face-to-face meeting, what kind of picture that I give it to you today, right? So some people usually they're going to say like, oh, this is like the star in the sky. And some other people thinking like, oh, this is maybe the head of the mouse after they die. You see the skeleton of the mouse, and maybe this is the one. But actually, this is not, all right? So this is the data that we collect before the pandemic come in, where a lot of motorcycle going on, yeah, in Jakarta, basically. This is the visualization of the data from the Jakarta. So in Jakarta, we have motorcycle taxi business, yeah? And then they become the decacorn of the startup, basically. Okay, they starting 2015, so after 5 years they have the asset greater than $10 billion US dollars, basically. And this guy is the chair, is the owner, and now he become the Minister of Education, by the way. All right, so this is all the business that they have. So what is the meaning of this picture? Maybe this will be the question when we do the visualization, right? So we can see from this picture, actually, like 60% of the visualization of this data. This one is about people who using go ride, meaning people using the motorcycle as a taxi. And then small number of that, they're using the car, they call it as go car. And about 30%, they use the go food, so they order the food and so on, right? So now this business, Gojek, already spread out to more than 10 countries at the moment, all right? And then before this coming, this business come in, so if you see in Jakarta, this is the situation in the Jakarta at that time. So I just trying to give some comparison for you that previously the data very limited, small number of data. When we visualize, this is the data that we have. But when the business come in, the data change become this way. All right, so I think that's the power of the data visualization in this context. This is one example. The second example, I'm going to show you about the COVID-19 in Indonesia, all right? So in Indonesia, we have 34 provinces and we have 514 districts. So if you see in the map here, we have like a very small space with the border here. They represent of the district, all right? So from the early of COVID-19 when they come to Indonesia on the 2nd of March 2020, so we try to monitoring how they grow, all right? And this is the situation that we have. We create four categories here: the area which is no impact, the area which is no case, the area with low risk, and the area with medium risk and the high risk. And what kind of parameter when we try to draw here, the parameter that we use, they are related with the number of the people to which get the positive COVID-19. And we have also what we call as the PDP. PDP means patient under surveillance, and then ODP means the people under observation, basically. And then we also try to learn about what happened with the hospital, about the readiness, how many for example, bed that available, yeah. And then the population density for every single province or every single district, and number of the airport, and the number of port for the maritime thing, yeah, the transportation in the sea, and then also the based on the country border also. And back to 16 July 2020, we have at that time around 54 districts still have no impact. And 48 of the district with no case, so meaning more, around 202 district are still okay. So the color still green. At that time, the country is still possible to be survived. There is no lockdown yet at that time, except for several country which is they have the high risk. Yeah, 31 district they have high risk. You can see the color will be red here. So the red one, we not allow people to move from that area to the other area, okay? And I'm going to show you in a minute how we track every single of them. More than 200,000 people, we try to track them, by the way. Just for your information, the population in Indonesia at the moment, nearly 270 million people, basically, all right? And then back into this data, 48 district with no case, 204 district low risk, and 177 with the medium risk. After some time, after 1 month, so this is the situation, all right? So we have like 32 district and around 42 district with no case and with no impact here. And then the number of the district with low risk increasing, become 174, and the medium risk also increase also, become to 237. And the high risk, we are lucky, previously was on July, in the middle of July, 17th of July, we have like 31 district. They are reduced a little bit to 31. So we see the behavior, actually some of the people, they are managed to recover. Some of them die, of course. But the low risk and the medium risk increasing. And just to a week ago, 10 days ago, so what happened is this is the situation in Indonesia, yeah. So really surprising me, starting from 1st September, everything increased dramatically, all right, in terms of the one who get infected by the COVID-19. So 58 district become really high risk. The government mentioned they cannot, you know, moving from one city to the other city, from one district to the other city. Maybe you call it as a lockdown. We have different description about lockdown in this context. I'm going to explain it later on here. And then last 10 days ago, so we have only 41 district that they have no impact and no cases. and then 111 district with the low risk and 304 with the medium risk. So if you can see this picture, actually we try to visualize based on the data that we have, and then we try to see how the progress that we have in every single district basically. Now we're thinking also about the productivity. So we need to think about the economic perspective also, of economic view. So every single of the district, how ready they are to doing the productivity, to doing the economic the activity basically. So we divide become like a six zone here. So if the zone still green, meaning they're going to allow to do their own business basically. As I mentioned earlier, we have like 17,504 island, a lot of small island, there is no impact for the COVID-19. So for the type of island, we allow them to doing their own productivity basically, yeah. So we have like 329, around 64% at the time back in on July 16, that they are in the lockdown situation. We not allow them to move because of the number of they infected by the COVID-19 was quite high. And then the week after that, so previously this one is 16 July, 329. And then when we go to 19 August, we are lucky the number a little bit decreased a little bit. Okay, but when we go to 10 days ago, this one is the data from 21st September. Again, you know, the number that that we allow to do the productivity decreasing, yeah. So if I start again to back again to my data, previously to 329 of the district, they allow to do their business, and after that they reduce a little bit, become 329 after a month, and the other 1 month we have like only 281. So actually we are in the worrying situation at the moment. All right. So now, in terms of daily movement, so we the government allow for another office of the government. I'm trying to help them also basically to tracking every single of them if they have like two categories. Yeah, number one is what we call as ODP. ODP actually they are related with the people under observation. So they have some symptom, and then the hospital or the clinic, for example, they categorize them as people under surveillance. So we take all the data of them and we track them. And the other one is people with the PDP status. Yeah? PDP status means patient under surveillance. Yeah. So as you can see here, the total number of ODP and PDP at the time around 222, yeah? 1,000 people. And they are sitting and they are moving, actually some of them they are moving from one area to the other area. If you can see from my data here, nearly 2,000 people actually they are moving, and some of them they are moving until 20 kilometers. Yeah, the average of their moving around 20 kilometers for the people under observation, and people under under surveillance, they moving around 22 kilometers in average. All right. So then what is the treatment for them? Number one, we sending the message to them through the SMS. We ask them, please don't move. And the first day still moving, in the morning, for example, in the afternoon, they're still moving. So what happened is nearly night, we call them one by one. Okay, so this is trying to reduce the number of the people who are moving, and then they spread out the, we call it as the local transmission basically. So this is the way we do back in on July until today basically, yeah. And then we want to learn also based on our data, where is the province with the highest number of people that move. So we have here number the top level here is actually goes to the first the West Java, in the West Java, because the total number of the people in the West Java is the highest in the country. So around 358 people, they move from one point to the other point. And second one is to the capital city, to Jakarta, and then to East Java, number three, and then to middle of Java, the province called middle of Java, and one province what we call as Banten. So this is the situation that we have try to categorize, yeah, when we put as a red, for example, that one is the top level for the province when they try to move. So of course this is not easy stuff. We using the GSM network based on the base station, of course. And just for your information also, sometimes we understand some data maybe is incorrect, because when someone they got the infected by the COVID-19, they do the isolation, maybe the mobile phone was used by his family, yeah? His wife, his son, maybe his doctor, his uncle or something like that, and they move from one point to the other point. So, but in whatever situation, because that phone number is dedicated, belong to that person, so we track that device basically. All right. So I think that's two examples that I try to share with you how we should visualize the data. Number one is about the motorcycle taxi in Jakarta, and the second one is about the COVID-19 in relation to the movement and so on. All right. So just now I just sharing with you about the data visualization. I will go to the basic little bit quickly in 5 minutes. I hope I can explain it about the difference between AI and CI, and also the data mining. All right. So as everybody knows, I believe when we talking about the CI, computational intelligence, if someone asks what is computational intelligence actually, so this is the good definition. I collect a lot of definition at the moment. So in the right side, this is some definition about the CI, but I think the definition that I follow at the moment is this, yeah. So CI is considered as the theory, design, and application and development of the biologically and linguistically motivated computational paradigm. Under CI, based on the IEEE, I'm the chair of the CIS Computational Intelligence Society IEEE Indonesia. So under the umbrella of IEEE, we have like three main pillar, which is number one is neural network, number two is fuzzy system, and the third one is the evolutionary computation. And in the couple of my slides later on, we will see also, because of, you know, in the world, the computer intelligence also growing, then the pillar growing also. Yeah. So the latest one that we follow, actually we have like five pillar. I'm going to go to that point later in a minute. And when we ask about what is the AI actually, so the AI is the ability to learn, to understand, deal with the new situation. That's the basic definition from the AI. And then the AI can be considered as the study on how to make computer do things at which computer are doing better basically. And when we're talking about the AI, artificial intelligence, actually we want to create the intelligent system. We want to create the intelligent behavior. And of course, both of them, CI and AI, they encompass the computing paradigm. For example, like ambient intelligent artificial life, ubiquitous computing, pervasive computing, and intelligent environment. So I think everyone also agree with me that computational intelligence can be considered as the sub-branch of the AI. But again, the question is, what is the difference among the two? Yeah. So I don't want to share with you the story here, but you can read from my slide. We have very limited time at the moment. So we can see the difference between AI and CI based on the hard computing and soft computing. The question is, what is hard computing and what is the soft computing? So hard computing basically can be considered as the traditional AI. Hard computing, they have like a very important of word here. Yeah. Number one is everything should be precision and everything should be certain. Why that happened like this way? Because the hard computing, which is used by AI basically, they are using the Boolean approach, meaning they're using the true or false. So the result usually goes to the true or the false one. Yeah. One problem from this logic is our natural languages sometimes cannot always be translated easily, yeah, to become zero and one. And then that appear with the soft computing. So you see my previous slide here, Lotfizadeh at the time, he is can be considered as the father of the fuzzy logic. Yeah, they the so in soft computing, we try to exploit the tolerance of imprecision. If we have like partial truth, for example, and something which is uncertain, what to do with that? So then, and soft computing is the answer. Yeah. So they should the solution from the soft computing, they should be low cost, yeah? And also the better report to the reality. I'm going to give you a couple example in a minute. And soft computing technique usually based on the fuzzy logic, must close to the way that human brain work, because we cannot see everything become just true or false. For example, when you drive your car and you do the parking, given a park spot, and as long as your car come into your car spot, that considered as true, as correct. But if you half of your car, for example, in the other side of your car spot, the one is incorrect. All right. So this kind of stuff that considered as the soft computing. Okay. So when we mention true, the question is what is true actually? If you follow the answer, the question that the example that I just sharing with you, you drive your car, you come to your car spot, maybe you know you move a little bit to the right, move a little bit to the left, or maybe exactly in the middle, they are all right as long as in the border. So something like that. So something that dealing with the hard computing, usually they go to AI. Something that they go to the soft computing, usually they go to the CI. So again, to the computer intelligence, they increase, yeah. Previously from 3 pillar, now they goes to the 5 pillar. So previously only artificial neural network, efficiently computing and fuzzy system, and then they appear the new one, yeah. The first one is artificial immune system and swarm intelligence. Let me share with you about the artificial immune system. What does it mean here? So in relation to the COVID-19, for example, there is one district, previously there is no COVID-19 come into this area, to that district, for example. And then slowly by slowly, what happened is the COVID-19 come in. When they come in, we are going to learn two things. Number one, how sensitive is the community when they got the COVID-19. Number two, what is the capability of that community to react to the situation? Okay, so that kind of approach we will study in the artificial immune system. So the immune system for the sensitivity of the community or the single person also that possible, or some certain object. And after it, how that object or that community, they react to the outside there. So we learn about that kind of approach, but basically. And
Excuse me, Teddy, if you can just conclude within 5 minutes, we have 5 minutes left.
Oh, 5 minutes left, all right.
Okay, thank you
for that, Prof. Mohammed SID. So, okay, I will sharing quickly. We just browsing my slide in the case. So this is the computational intelligence technique using AI, artificial neural network, go to the multi-layer of the hidden layer, for example, and they go to the deep learning. Yeah, and this one is about the evolutionary computation, goes to the genetic algorithm and so on. And this part is for the swarm intelligence. You can see here the for example, like an algorithm to see the optimization from this, and the immune system. This is the immune system, like I mentioned earlier, and then the fuzzy system, and so on. All right. So because only 5 minutes, I let you to browse my slide. I will not discussing about data mining, how the progressing of the data mining from the only 4 cycle previously, they move to the 6 other cycle with a different approach. And some way how the data mining solving the problem basically, all right? So we can do the starting from the verification, and the other approach is to discovery something based on the prediction, based on the description, and so on. Some other approach from the neural network, Bayesian model, SVM, and so on. We use SVM to predict the COVID-19. Now go to the agenda number 2 related with the, I will make it only 1 or 2 minutes for this, monitoring the COVID-19 in Indonesia, okay? I will skip for that. So this is the situation at the time when in Indonesia we have a big debating whether we need to do the lockdown or no. So how we learn about this? We try to collect a big data from the Twitter, and after we try visualize them. And then we learn that a lot of people that are pro with the lockdown, a quite big number of people, and only small number that understand the situation basically, and the government decide not to do the contract to a lockdown. And we study at the time based on the three countries. Okay, that if you see the line here, the dash line, this one represent of the Singapore and Korea with no lockdown. And the other one is Switzerland, they do the lockdown. And in some certain times, some country with the lockdown going up in terms of the number of people that infected by the COVID-19, and sometimes they are, you know, reducing also. So in the end here, if you see in the certain point of time, we can see like no lockdown, that's also possible to be decreasing also. So Indonesia in the position of no lockdown at the time. So this is the situation in Jakarta at the time. I want to share with you this is very important matters in the certain city. When one capital city, we try to create the lockdown, we do the lockdown on the 10th of April. What happened is the number of the infected one decreasing. But the impact in the different province surrounding to Jakarta, they are increasing. So meaning we try to save some certain area, but actually the other area, they have the big impact for that. So I will skip a couple of my slides to do the monitoring. And this is when I mentioned earlier about the situation in Indonesia. All right, we have like five big islands, Sumatra, Java, Kalimantan, Sulawesi, and Papua. So what happened is every single big island, the epicentrum, they are always moving from one province to the other province, for example, in Sumatra. Similarly with Java, sometimes in capital city, sometimes they go to the east, sometimes they go to the other city. But for Kalimantan, they always in the east of Kalimantan. Whereas from the Sulawesi here, they always in the south Sulawesi. And Papua, they're going to go to the Papua one, all right? And the epicentrum, for example, we go to not only to the district, but we go to the suburb level. For example, in Jakarta, we have like 267 suburbs. So we study every single of them. When we see the highest one, so we have very tight policy to the very simple small area, as we call it a sub-district or suburb, all right? So, and we rank them. And we also try to understand what happened because a couple suburb, they still have no infected at the time, all right? So now the last part of my talk, they're related with the prediction. So prediction is not simple. We use more than 20 approach with a big team that I have. So we learn about the use of the SIR, susceptible, infected, and recovered. I'm going to give you a couple sample data that we do. And we have also a lot of model with the SHARE. Yeah, susceptible, exposed, infection, and recovered people. And we also doing a lot of survey to see why the number of the people, especially for low and middle income, they are increasing dramatically compared to the low and upper of people. So we do a questionnaire approach, and we use the ANOVA to see what is the impact from the. And then we use also the machine learning here. We using the deep learning. We using the SVR. So from more than 20 approach that we use, this is the lesson learned that from my team. Yeah, I mentioned here there is no good prediction model. Mathematical model, that's good maybe, but when we implement it, sometimes they become not a good model. Only because the assumption are not quite precise and not good enough to represent the reality. So then I mentioned here, because so many debating in my country and Indonesia, it is better not to predict if it is produced bad prediction because they become debating in the community. So when we are going to predict, the prediction become compulsory if we want to create some guidance for the policy making. So this is couple approach that we do. using support vector regression, some code, I put it a little bit there to give you some idea. And then this one is some review of the prediction. I give you one lesson learned here. So back to March, for example, we have like 99% of the prediction. And then on April, we have like 27, and the rate only 10. Why that happened? Because the government put the policy in the good way, and then the community follow. But after some time, the community they don't follow the government suggestion. So what happened in the end? They increase back again. That's the situation that we have. Then this number showing the situation basically. And then this is the prediction which is mistaken. We predict in certain number, but we got the wrong in term of the prediction basically. So a lot of prediction that we do, and this one also we using the mathematical model at the time. For quite some time they are going very well, but after some time they moving to a different location, all right, to a different way. And we try to predict when they going to go to the top and going down, all right. So give me another 2 minutes, Prof. So Prof. Muhammad SID. So this is the prediction from Singapore at the time, who are trying to predict people around the world basically, and we learn from there. And in the end, they acknowledge in his disclaimer, yeah, in this website, that the model and data are inaccurate to the complex, evolving, and heterogeneous reality of different countries over time. In the end, also they mention a race prediction are no longer valid because the real world scenario have changed rapidly. So my point here is prediction is not easy. You cannot just, you know, because very dynamic and so many, and but we need it for making the policy maker, yeah. And this is our prediction. We do also our prediction. This is a very optimistic prediction, and this is very pessimistic prediction. And we do a lot of things here using a polynomial with the rich regression and so on basically. And we try to compare from our result, yeah, from the SHEAR model and SHEAR model in the national level, and also the from the province level. And we learn also at the times that if we learn about the local maxima, so in Indonesia we have already the two wave, okay, and then this September actually the third wave that we have. So yeah, this is the prediction from the capital city, and as you can see, we put like three zone here. The red zone, our situation that we have, we expect to go to green, and after yellow, after that we go to the green, which is not easy at the moment, yeah. And this is showing the data that we have. All right, Sumatra, this is all the big islands, Sulawesi, Kalimantan, and Papua. All right. So in conclusion, so we just discussed about how we visualize the data. This very complex matter actually, and based on the computational intelligence, based on the AI, and based on the data mining, and also with some related concept like SIR and SEIR, yeah. And we need to use the emerging technology to monitoring the COVID-19 epicentrum. We use the mobile phone, and then using the GSM network, collect the data, see whether the people is moved or not. And of course, we need to do some evaluation, some verification on it. And then the prediction, like I mentioned earlier, is not easy, and sometimes they're going somewhere else, and we need to do the prediction for every single day, basically. And prediction is very important to support the policy making in combating the COVID-19. So with that, thank you, Prof. Muhammad SID. That's all my presentation. If welcome for if there is any question from the floor.
Thank you so much, Professor Teddy, mentor, for the very interesting talk. I have only a couple of questions because we are short of time. We can take them. So the first question is, how do you track the movement of people?
So what happened is, tracking is my favorite work, basically. I'm working since 2002. I got a couple patent on it. So you can track people indoor, and you can track people also outdoor, all right? So how to doing the outdoor? Of course, using GSM network, all right? Using the GPS. Okay. And the problem is when you're using the GPS, when they come into the certain location, they will to the indoor location, we cannot track them. So then what we're going to do? So we basically set up one big server, and then the people who got ODP or PDP observe people under observation or patient under surveillance. We collect all the number of their mobile phone. We note also, we take note also for the email, and then we collaborate with the internet service provider. So they got the big data about the mapping of the Indonesian location, basically based on the base station. So based on that situation, we collect the data. That's one way. The other way is when they browsing, and we know that they came from the certain phone number, for example, then using the IP number, we can collect the location of the people also. If you're using the GSM network, the accuracy about the best situation for the accuracy around 92.5 meters. Not good precision, by the way, but we can use it. If you have the a good area with the Wi-Fi, for example, in some building we do that thing. Not all the building in Indonesia, no, but we have some spot. So the access to the access point, for example, then we can predict the location of them. So for that, that really depend on the data that we compare it to the user location, all right? And then when you have like 2,200 people and you want to track all in together, that's not easy stuff. So we hiring a lot of a good programmer. We track every single of them and we collect the data, and then we email them, we SMS them, using SMS, we sending the WhatsApp. If they still move, then we call them. So we have one other unit to call them one by one. So using that way, then we expect that the local transmission will be reduced. But you know, there is some other factor that we need to consider for that, Prof. Number one is the culture of the people. In Indonesian culture, I don't see that, especially the people who have the low literacy level, basically, yeah. So they are still, you know, we give them select. And they have the good argument also. They mentioned they cannot stay at home because they don't have any saving. They have to survive for this family. So they have to go outside. So then no other choice. So that's my answer, Abram. Okay. Thank you for that.
Okay, thank you. But maybe you can give a quick answer to another question, which is, how are you thinking to improve your model predictions?
Increase the
predictions. Model predictions. Yeah.
Okay, so what happened is why the prediction all usually they goes to different way because of the assumption. Okay, I will give you one sample variable. Yeah, to the one who asked me about the equation. For example, the probability for me today to meet someone who get infected by COVID-19 is, for example, only 0.05. Other people, maybe their probability around 0.1. Some other maybe 1% or 2%. Now, can you imagine one district with, say, for example, 2 million people, or 500 people, for example, and we try to get some generic number for the probability of all the people and for the district, and we put it in the system. Sometimes they are close to the situation in the real world, but sometimes it's not. And please remember, even the difference is only 0.00005, for example, then the prediction will going to the different direction. So that's something which is not easy stuff. So how to make it increase? If we follow the government, that they have to stay at home, for example, then maybe the probability will be going down. If they're going down, the lowest the probability for example, meeting other people, and also, of course, still a lot of data. For example, the number which is infected, they also depend on how many people that we testing them. So I have some a part also in my slide, but we not enough time to share with you what is the weakness from doing the testing, for example. So this one also become the impact. If every single data is we got the data which represent of the real world, I believe the prediction will be in the good way. I think that's my answer, Prof.
Okay, thank you so much, Professor Teddy Mantour, for the wonderful talk and for the discussion of and the answers you gave to the different questions. But there are many other questions that we will share with you, and I will really appreciate if you can just give your feedback to the people who ask those questions. We will also share your presentation and the video with all the participants. So once again, thank you so much. And it's a real pleasure to see you again after a long time, Teddy. So please keep in touch.